Hi, Allison.
Hi, Liz.
You write one of our most popular research reports for clients called Top of Mind, and you've recently published a new report on an issue that's on the minds of almost everyone, how and when to reopen the U.S. economy. Tell us about this report.
Of course, there's no other topic besides reopening that is more top of mind for our clients right now. I'm not a medical expert, Liz. At Goldman Sachs in general, we're not experts on this virus, but we do have the opportunity to speak to leading experts about these pressing questions. I spoke specifically for this publication with University of Pennsylvania's Dr. Zeke Emanuel, Duke University's Dr. Mark McClellan, and Harvard University's Dr. Barry Bloom to see what they had to say about this important topic.
Let's start on the health front. What did the experts who you spoke with say about how the trajectory of the virus should factor into a reopening?
So the key point the experts I spoke to make is that since the virus is pervasive and, you know, just very easily transmitted, as we all know, we will see outbreaks as we reopen, and we need to ensure that our hospital systems can handle them when they do. So at least for the experts we spoke to, again, just seeing a sustained decline in cases, which is the national guideline recommended as gating criteria for reopening, it's not enough. We really need to see a low absolute rate of infection. And of course, all of the experts are also emphasizing that in order to determine that, in order to really determine the trajectory of the disease, we must increase testing, and particularly among the broader community, in order to identify what we've all heard of as these asymptomatic carriers of the virus, which can be spreaders, when we're really just not doing a great job of that right now.
The first phase of a reopening is already happening in some parts of the country. What do the experts you spoke with say about what a safe reopening looks like?
Look, the recommended phases really are intuitive. Establishments that open first really should be the ones where we can maintain social distancing, we can avoid close contact, we can space out customers, really much like we're already doing with grocery stores today, where only a handful of customers are being let in at a time, customers and grocery checkers are wearing face masks, and so forth. So that's why opening places like salons and tattoo parlors early on has been heavily questioned, because of course you can take all the precautions in the world, it's still gonna be hard to avoid close contact and a potential spread situation in those types of businesses. At the other end of the spectrum, protections for very vulnerable populations, like people living in senior facilities, should be lifted last. And again, that seems pretty intuitive. Another thing to note that the experts noted is that, at least for the ones we spoke to, there seems to be a growing consensus that places like schools and camps can open earlier on. That's because children have been seen to be less affected by this virus. It's posing much less of a health risk for them. And of course, getting kids back into these types of institutions will be pretty essential for getting the economy back up and running, given the need for parents to be able to return to work. But I should also add that the experts think that returning back to school and so forth should be optional in the event that, kids can be carriers of this disease. And if you have someone vulnerable living at home, that's a risk that some households might not want to take.
Well, the critical turning point for reopening the economy will come when there's a vaccine. What are you hearing about the timing of that?
Well, the reality is most of them are still talking about 12 to 18 months away, with our experts actually leaning towards the later end of that timeframe. But one point they emphasized that I thought was very interesting is that even though that's later than we might all want, it actually would be a record fast timeline for getting a vaccine into the marketplace. Historically, vaccines have taken anywhere from 8 to 15, 17 years to reach market. So what is the difference here? Basically, drug companies are now using revolutionary platforms to develop vaccines, which are vastly more efficient than developing individual vaccines for individual viruses. So according to the experts, we saw these platforms first beginning to be rolled out in looking at diseases like Ebola and Zika and even the flu, and it's now being utilized here. The other factor that's speeding up this timeline is that some companies are actually taking the remarkable step of financing and pre-committing to capacity to manufacture vaccines in the massive amounts that are going to be needed globally when we do get one. this is a financially risky but a really important step to getting vaccines out to the wider population sooner. And so some of our experts actually said that, you know, more of this type of model should be replicated with more companies, you know, pre-committing to actually ramping up massive dosage, which is, you know, very unusual historically.
And what about effective treatments?
So the good news is that at least the experts we speak to think it's very likely that we get an effective treatment long before we get a vaccine. There are literally hundreds of clinical trials either ongoing or planned for this virus. And we've seen recent encouraging news from Gilead on trials of its drug, remdesivir, which really reinforces this.
There's a lot of talk around the idea of herd immunity. How should we be thinking about that?
So there are a couple of points to touch on here. To start, what is herd immunity? It's simply the point when enough people in the population are immune to a disease that there's broad resistance to its continued spread. One of the experts we spoke to actually quibbled with the term herd immunity because it doesn't mean that people who haven't been infected are immune. Herd immunity protects people who are susceptible. So the calculation is that about 60 to 70% of the population, maybe even 80% of the population, would have to have protective antibodies. So they'd have to basically be immune to make it unlikely that if someone not yet infected, so a susceptible person, went into a room, that they would be infected, because the chances that the other people in the room are infected are so low. The reality is that we don't have a great sense of how many people in the US have antibodies that might imply immunity, because we're really just not testing very widely for this at this point. But the limited testing that has been done suggests that only about 5 to 10% of the population, maybe a little bit higher in some of the hard hit areas, have antibodies at this point. So that basically means that most of America is still susceptible to the disease, and we are very far away from achieving herd immunity. So we're not gonna have the luxury of that as we reopen.
And so what about antibody testing?
When we speak to the experts, what they have to say is basically that even though we're hearing a lot about antibody testing right now, these tests are still very new and there are a lot of doubts about them and what they are really telling us at this point. You know, as we all know, this virus is very new and there is still a lot we don't know about to what extent the presence of antibodies suggests immunity to the disease. And even if it does suggest some immunity, how long that immunity would last. And many of the antibody tests out there right now were actually not developed to test for immunity. And so they have lots of problems with false negatives and so forth. So a word of caution really about this from the experts. With more time and testing, hopefully we will learn more about the evolution of immunity to the disease, as well as, you know, get better tests to detect antibodies, but that's not the case today. But the main takeaway is that we are unlikely to achieve herd immunity anytime soon. And so even when antibody tests improve, they'll play some role, but not a central role in reopening.
And finally, what does a reopening mean for the future of an economic recovery?
Again, the key point the experts make is that any reopening must be phased. We already discussed that, which in and of itself suggests a gradual and uneven economic recovery. That is in line with our forecast at Goldman Sachs. We are expecting to see double-digit growth in the second half of the year, but from a very low base, so that economic activity is likely to end the year well below pre-coronavirus levels. The experts also stress that the extent to which we can smoothly navigate this gradual reopening and, you know, economic recovery is really up to the establishments and the public in general to adhere to the guidelines that, you know, everyone is suggesting, you know, maintaining social distancing, wearing masks, washing your hands. You know, even with these practices, it's very unlikely that we'll avoid outbreaks, as we mentioned earlier. But these practices should help reduce them and the severity of them, which reduces the likelihood that we'll actually have to, you know, roll back reopening steps, which is certainly a possibility in this environment. But one of the most interesting points I think the experts made about the prospect of economic recovery is that polling and other evidence suggests that the problem with the economy isn't a supply side one, meaning that businesses are closed and therefore people aren't going to them and they're not spending money at these businesses. The problem is a demand side one, meaning that people are afraid to go out because of health concerns. And if that is the case, just reopening stores and restaurants won't lead to people filling them. And the more that's the case, the longer the recovery could take.
Thanks, Allison.
Thanks, Liz. It was great talking to you.